when we did the video for Prisoner, the song.
We were doing the video in Soweto somewhere, and it was during the time when Soweto was a bit scary. There were a lot of guns and things going on there.
In the video, there's a car with like crooks or other bad boys and stuff. So I had like a gun, and the car was like spinning around, and there was like four of us standing by the doors and stuff like that.
And I had this gun, and there was this police van that was passing by, and they didn't know that there's a video being shot, and they thought I'm some criminal with a gun at a shopping center or something, and they came for me, and the director had to come and go, no, it's a video camera, you know, things like that. And they nearly shot me, you know. But I really enjoy doing that because I love making movies.
I did three movies. We did one called Voice in the Dark with John Savage. And it was nice doing it. I like horror movies. And I like the creativity behind them. Those guys like Stephen King, you know, they write those movies. It takes a lot of work to do that. You got to have a very creative brain. We go on stage, they say, oh, he can't do that on stage sober. He must be drunk, or he must be on drugs or anything. I don't do all of those things. It's just the music that just makes us do what we do or look the way we do on stage.
This one is called No Matter How Hard They Can Try, But Nobody Can Stop Reggae, because reggae is strong!
Lucky Dube is a Rastafarian, depending, of course, on, you know, how you look at it. Because some people say a Rastafarian is one who plays reggae, one who has dreadlocks, and one who smokes ganja.
Rastafari philosophy teaches that no one should not question nobody's faith, you know. But Lucky Dube have the outer appearance of Rasta, dreadlocks, they sing reggae music. Some tell me that the other time he appeared in Selimatunzi and denouncing fundamental aspect of Rastafari faith, the divinity of His Majesty, the herb smoking, the herb ganja among I and I, you see?
Because Rastafari is not such as ism like socialism and, you know, those kind of ism, but it's more like the life that you live. Reggae music is about the life that the Rastafari people live.
Well, I took upon Rastafarianism not as a religion, but as a way of life. Because religion is sometimes like politics, it divides people.
Sure.
If you belong to some religion, I belong to another religion, we sometimes don't go very well together.
Right.
You see, like when you say Christian, a Christian is a person who believes in Christ and who advocates Christ's divinity. Are we talking about Rasta? Rasta talk about Rastafari's divinity. And you can't be Rasta without acknowledging Rastafari.
What connection does reggae music and Rasta have, right? So now, because it's the gospel music for the Rastafari people. So now, for you to really take it on a holistic physical level. That means to say you have to carry the image also. So what I see with Lucky, him love the music, him play the music, and him play it properly too, but at the same time, him only took the image of the Rastafari man.
The people that brought reggae to the world, Bob Marley, Peter Tosh and them, came with this ganja thing. They smoked ganja, and that's like, wow, if you want to do reggae music and do it very well, yeah, then you got to smoke ganja.
Right.
Or if you do reggae and you want to do it well, you got to have dreadlocks.
Dreadlocks were there in Africa before reggae music, before everything, before guitars and before recording studios. Black people in Africa were dreadlocks.
The driving force that drive the origin of reggae music was a Rastafari philosophy, the Rastafari consciousness, the Rastafari thinking.
Rasta is about consciousness. Rasta is about awareness.
You have a reggae icon who might not necessarily be Rasta. But I'm not saying Lucky Dube, he is a Rasta or not, you know? I say, Rasta said, who feels it knows it.
There's a man that came to South Africa in 1976. His name was Jimmy Cliff, who came to perform at Orlando Stadium. And then I actually went to Orlando Stadium just to see Jimmy Cliff performing, because in my mind I had this reggae star that's coming and I wanted to see what do I need to do to have a reggae star that can be like Jimmy Cliff or be better than Jimmy Cliff.
Lucky Dube and Stamila were one of the reasons why I wanted to get into the music industry. But at that stage he wasn't doing reggae. He was doing more of his traditional music. And I joined Gallo in 1984. And it was very soon after that that Lucky's got into reggae.
He had an opportunity. He was a genuine, passionate believer and lover of reggae music. But he's a lover of reggae music, not Bhangra and not that stuff. He could have adapted a style, but he became old school reggae in a way that reinterpreted, which in an African context made it fresh.
I had this love for reggae music, you know, from when I started doing music. I had a great love for reggae music, what we were hearing from Jamaica, Peter Tosh, Bob Marley and stuff. I loved reggae very much, but at the time in South Africa, I couldn't do reggae music because of the government of the time. I think they found reggae to be making people aware of the political situation. So the government at the time didn't like reggae music very much. I started doing Mbakanga, but when I felt the time was right, then I did the switch, which made a lot of people angry at the time, because the Mbakanga stuff that I did was very popular. People liked it and it was just a big thing. People liked it, and since nobody was doing reggae music in South Africa, even the record company was not happy about it, because they didn't know what was going to happen.
Richard Saluma was Lucky's producer, and they came to me and they said they wanted to record reggae music. I said, but there's reggae comes from Jamaica, how can you record African reggae? They said, no, we want to do African reggae. They went into the studio and they recorded, and that was the first recording that Lucky made, was with Gallo. That album sold over 500,000 units. Ministers of religion have visited me many times to talk about it. They say to me, I got a believer, a part of believer. It's a bad habit for a man. But when I try to leave it, my friends came.
I started working before I went to school, actually, right. Because there was basically no money to take me to school and everything. Yeah. So I started working just doing odd garden jobs and stuff like that.
Yes.
And supporting my grandmother and my other sisters. And right. To me, that was being a man. Okay. You know, I became a man at the age of six.
My childhood is what makes my song. The experience I had as a child is what I sing about today.
And obviously because of his lyrics and because of the message, Africans identify with him.
What he sings about is what every human being goes through in this world.
We like him, I think, because it's conscious, you know, and that's why our parents were okay with exposing us to that music, because it's saying the right stuff.
A message that is real to the public, the masses of people can identify with what he's speaking about, you know.
I really believe, you know, he was just like Oprah, Bob Marley, you know, he was one of the people who really conscientized the people or our community about what's happening around us, you know.
I enjoy what he's saying, because that's more or less what I preach in my writing. I'm a poet, so I appreciate what he's saying. The cats and the dogs have forgiven each other. What's wrong with us? He's got great messages to convey to the people.
Other public loved it. Are you kidding me? Because we were all ready for it. And there needed to be songs like that to come out and underline, you know, the whole accentuate the positive thing. That was one of the things. And it was just so nicely put out there. It wasn't, get out of my face. It was just, dude, gotta live together, man. You know? And it was done in such a sweet, sweet way and sort of encapsulated it and wrapped up in a reggae tune. I mean, it's very easy to swallow.
You know, I mean, a lot of the Lucky songs were banned. And I think Together Was One was also banned for a while. Hey, it was just a song, a fabulous song, that everybody could identify with. And I think that radio specifically at that stage identified with it.
We went to the studio, I think it was Springbok Radio, they called it at the time, or some radio station there, which was mainly a white radio station. And so I was being interviewed by, I think it was Alex J. And he played the song Together as One on that radio. And at that time it was like a no-no black music on there, and a lady afterwards phoned the station to say, hey, tell that guy there he must go to Radio Bantu, which is now Radio Zulu, he must go and play his music at Radio Bantu, not here, and stuff like that.
The first song by a black South African that struck a massively responsive chord with the predominantly white audience, and the song was Together as One.
For me, it was a great achievement that they played that music on that station, you know, the first time, and it talked about apartheid and the whole thing. It was great fun.
Together as One was a song that did exactly that. It brought a nation together, and that's certainly what it did for his career. And for South Africans.
And he just hit it off with everybody, and I think he brought a lot more people together than a lot of other musos in this country.
I think the time is right now in South Africa that people get together. Too many people hate apartheid.
The reason of coming with Prisoner, it's the time we're inspired by our brothers who are in exile, okay? And then also is the time we started knowing more about Ubaba uMandela.
Prisoner was just, the timing was perfect. You know, we were just coming out of the apartheid era. Mandela was just being released. Lucky was singing about all the suffering he as a person personally suffered, but also, you know, the rest of South Africa.
We then look at how can we relay this message to the people of South Africa, whoever is going to be listening, or and then to be able to know that we really want Mandela to be released now. Lucky was finding himself doing a double job there because he was going to sit down and write the song politically. Okay, and then after writing it, and then we will then sit down and change it into something that it may not pull him into jail.
You know, the time Prisoner came out, you had Chico doing Soldier, you had a lot of tracks which had political content. There was a lot of sort of double meaning stuff, hidden layered. A lot of guys were nervous to actually set out their stall, as it were, musically, but for fear of problems with the security police. Lucky didn't worry about it, and his message was none too mixed. By some miracle, people like Lucky managed to drag it down to a level where you could say, okay, well, look, enough's enough. We're all in this together. Stand together or collapse apart. And good sense prevailed. And he's one of the guys that made it happen.
But today, yeah, I am a prisoner.
He never took a political stance. He positioned himself with the people as opposed to any one political party. I think more than anything else, the only time he really got very, very involved in politics to a certain extent was when he got involved in educating people the first time we had to go to the voting polls.
I had to go out to the people, teach people how to vote, especially like in the farm areas. That's where we went, and just educating people. It was very important for me. I think it was a very necessary service that I did there.
Thing that catch me the first time I heard him is that he sounds very much like Peter Tosh, you know. At that time, Peter Tosh was already passed, and I heard somebody sounding like him but with different lyrics, you know.
Peter Tosh is the guy I look up to. His music still inspires me even today. You know, he was a great musician, very I liked everything about him. Yeah, he still inspires me. Guys like Hugh Masekela, guys like Mama Miriam, and Hot Sticks. Hot Sticks, he inspired me even more than musically, but just as a person. When Harare was like the happening thing in South Africa, Sipho was Sipho. And even today, you meet him, Sipho, he's still the same Sipho as he was in the past.
When I first had Lucky, in fact, I actually told Gallo, I said, watch Lucky. There is talent in abundance in Lucky. One of the best voices this country's ever seen.
He's been like that, and sometimes I wish I could be like that when I'm like older. Let me be like that. I've been trying to get him to come and play on some of our songs, but I just can't get him to do that.
I can only say, Lucky, I'm waiting. Don't wait until I have no energy.
It's very expensive. I can't afford him. Every album that we've released after 87 has been successful. But the way I look at how successful an album is, fine, it's okay, you go, you look at how much you got for that particular album. But also, you go further than that, you know, this album or this song, how has it touched people in their daily lives? Has it done something for the people? When we did the song Remember Me, we did that song, it was about me, it was about what happened to me. But then when we go out performing and stuff like that, we meet a lot of people who would say, you know, that song was not about Lucky Dube, it was about me. And also, in a political situation where you get politicians to listen to what you're saying, and that we regard as success as well.
It's always positive. It's always keeping the society fresh in new ideas and things that will heal, you know.
I know, like it always call comfort, you know, but a frustration, right? Ega Pending Spear was hating on him because he was selling more records in NY and shit.
Yeah.
And he ordered meat.
Wandering up and down the streets of Soweto, no place to call my home.
Me and Lucky Dube, we grew up together, actually. The person behind us, it was my grandma, you know? She's the lady that made sure that we eat and we have clothing to go to school and to do a lot of things. But unfortunately, she was not very rich, but she tried and bring us up in that particular kind of life.
It wasn't a happy childhood as I look at it now, but at that time, I mean, I knew nothing better,
yeah.
You know, that was what I was getting, and I thought, well, that's what life is all about. But now, having gone and seen things, you know, growing up without your father and without your mother, and, you know, no clothes, no food sometimes, and all of that, it was a hard thing. I mean, as it was a very poor situation. You know, it was very poor, but I mean, I grew up, you know, because of my grandmother. Because I know sometimes she would go, you know, without food. She would go on without food for like 3 days or something, but she would always make sure that I get something to eat. I was the only one that, I mean, she was responsible for at that time, but as I grew up, there were like other kids that came in, because the thing with my grandmother is that she accept everybody.
She was like a mother to us, you know? She was a mother to us. My mom was there. It was nice to say mom, but Coco was still the best.
When we're on stage, I always think that I wish my grandmother could be here to see, you know, us do this. And so when I went to the studio that year, it was like, okay, I'm doing this, this is good, but she won't see this, you know, in her physical being. But I know she sees and she feels this in her spiritual being. That's basically the only comfort I have right now, that in her spiritual being she sees all this. Because, you know, when we work and we get paid and stuff like that, I would go to her place and bring her groceries, bring her money and stuff, and she would say things like, so where do you work, really? Where do you work? I say, hey, I'm a musician, I sing. She says, no, I understand the singing part. You do that, I see you on TV and stuff, but what's your job? What's your real job? You know, it's like doing music is not real, but I have to have like a real job. And, but you know, she was the person in my life. She was the main man in my life.
When he goes into studio, he becomes a very different person. He becomes very introvert. Obviously, he starts digging deep in terms of getting his songs and his lyrics right. And he goes into a production and a pre-production period that lasts for 3 or 4 months. And he becomes a bit of a hermit because he's in creative mode. And so he's not one of those artists that just goes into studio and records and everything. He obviously digs very deep in terms of the issues that he's dealing with and wants to bring out.
He will not allow anybody else to come in, no matter, you know, only the people that are directly involved in the session. But phones are turned off and no one is allowed to disturb.
In the contract it says a year and one album a year or stuff like that. But we have this understanding that I'll go to the studio when I'm ready. Whether it's after 2 years or 3 years, I'll go in when I'm ready. Studio is very, very difficult, you know, because that is where everything happens. That is where studio is the first place where you get to hear the music. Because when you hear a song in your head, it's just you that hears the song. It's just you that knows the song. And when you have to get the band to play it now in the studio, the sound engineer to record it and stuff, you're thinking all of those things, is it gonna come out right? You know, maybe you heard it in your head, it was nice, but when it gets played by the band in the studio, it's not coming out the way you heard it in your head.
It's a revolution time. It's a revolution time.
think it was possibly the third trip that we did to Uganda, and we were in a stadium, and people had been queuing for hours, for days. Again, 65,000 people. And unfortunately, the promoters allowed too many people into the stadium. And I don't know if you've ever seen Lucky perform. When he goes onto stage, he runs and his dreadlocks fly. And that creates a mass hysteria. But we were on stage and he ran onto stage, and I could see straight away as he ran onto stage that we were going to have a crowd problem. And the crowd started surging forward. And there was a lot of trampling going on, and we were trying to get the kids out of the crowd and the stampede. And I turned to him while I was on stage and I said to him, take it down, take the tone down, you know, get into a ballad so we can get into a control crowd. And he literally told me to get off the stage. He was screaming at me. And there was this whole fight going on between him and I on the stage. And I had the military coming up the stairs and they wanted to stop the show and everything. But I panicked, and he knew exactly how he could control the crowd.
How long is this gonna last? 'Cause we've come so far, so far.
That happens all the time, you know. People love the music, and I'm very happy about it, you know. It's chaos, yes, when people rush into the stadium, breaking down gates and stuff, climbing over walls just to see you and stuff like that. It's all very exciting. It's all very good to say, hey, I'm just a guy, you know. I'm really nothing, but here's people doing whatever they can to just get a glimpse of me.
I saw him twice, I think, in the biggest stadium, and it was nice. It was very nice. People dancing, singing, know the lyrics. Even sometimes they don't understand, but catch the vibe, and it's peace and love, harmony.
He'd been in Nairobi, man. People broke down gates, you know what I mean? He's one of the most popular reggae artists. He can't even come there anymore, you know what I'm saying? Because, I mean, it won't be a concert, it'll be chaos. He said it himself. He cannot perform there.
One time, I think it was Numia or Fiji or some of those Pacific islands, we had prisoners escaping from jail to come and see our show. Because we were performing there, and so like 5 songs into the set, we saw people just running around, and there's all like this craziness going, and I'm like, okay, what's happening? I'm thinking, okay, no, the sound is really happening. Look at them moving. And yet it was the prisoners being chased by police, and now the police are like re-arresting them. And it was like, oh, okay. And we went back on stage and we like pleaded with the police, because we don't get to do those shows like every year. Maybe it's like every 10 years or every 7 years. So we like pleaded with the police, okay, can they just watch the show till the end, and then you can just take them, it's okay, you can keep them there, but you know, they escaped to see the show. Let them at least see the show. And the police were okay, they were reasonable, because they were like dancing there with the prisoners and stuff in handcuffs. And I'm thinking, you know, it's very touching, it's nice.
The sound systems that we use in these countries usually aren't sufficient for the amount of people there. But when everybody's singing along, they basically singing every word, and I mean, which really drowns out the PA system. But the vibe is just amazing. It's just incredible experience to be in the middle of these shows.
Started music in South Africa, right? It's the people in South Africa that like gave us a stamp of approval. basically. And so, but what happens now, reason we don't perform that much here is because of the fact that there's now a lot of opportunities that come up internationally, some of which can never be repeated. And so we're taking those opportunities. We go out there, we perform. And sometimes, yes, we would go for like 2 years not performing in South Africa at all. But we have done work here, like with the Live Aid concert that we did here, you know. And also sometimes it is good to like stay away for a while and then come back again.
For a very long time, the artists that were the big artists, the icons, in the 80s and the 90s, new music moved on, you know, Kwaito came. Those artists didn't have the performance schedules that they had before. You have to go back and ask yourself this question. Lucky Dube, Ladysmith Back Mambazo, the Mawatela Queens, all those artists still tour internationally. So I don't think for a minute that Lucky left his South African audience. Lucky would love to perform in South Africa as much as possible, but he did see the South African audience dwindle.
The House of Exile. Indeed, another hit recording is called Prisoner. Another one that says, I've got you, babe. Together as one, let's welcome to Jamaica and to Reggae Sunsplash 92. Let's hear it for Lucky Dube.
Jamaica. That was what, 91, 92. That was actually one of the greatest moments, you know, in my life as a reggae musician, because every reggae artist in the world dreams about performing at the Reggae Sunsplash. So when we got that invitation, we were so happy. We went there, and there was all these great bands, and the stadium was like full, and it was just unbelievable. And we were there from South Africa, and it was great. So we got on and we performed. We had like maybe 20 minutes or 15 minutes there. And Jamaican audience is very, very difficult, because you go there and you start performing, they just stand there and they look at you. You're thinking, oh boy, is the sound happening? Is what's happening? But we did our 20 minutes, and everybody was dancing, clapping and stuff. And we got off stage, they wanted an encore. And the organizers, I think it was Mr. Johnson, he came back to us and he says, please, please, please go back and do some more. And we were happy, because they told us later that that was the first time that it happened like that, because with the Sunsplash, it's all time, you know, time is very important. If they gave you like 15 minutes or 20 minutes, that's it. You don't do more, you don't go back. They said it only used to happen during Bob Marley's time and Peter Tosh and all that. And so we were very happy.
There was nobody else doing what he did, which is why he got invited to Reggae Sunsplash, which is why he got the international recognition. Because he was a continuation of Marley of old. He was not Apache Indian. He was not Shabba Ranks. He was Lucky Dube.
Thank you.
I'm reggae. I mean, the song I wrote some years ago saying, you know, the bed that I sleep on is a reggae bed and everything I do is reggae. So, I mean, I'll always be reggae.
I'd like to thank God really to bring Lucky next to me or to have a cousin brother like Lucky.
His future will always be music, you know. I would like to do music for as long as I can and tour for as long as I can. Maybe when I'm about 65, 70, I would still be touring and stuff. But yeah, the future is music. Yeah.